Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how the show works. There's teachers from Dallas, teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dallas Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now, remember, you can also send your question to our website. Go to homeworkhotline.org, click on the Ask Back button, and send in your questions. Okay, it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for the creature teaser.
All right. Okay, this is a good one. This mammal likes to spend most of its time below the Antarctic ice. They like the chilly waters where most of their food sources can be found. This creature can dive down almost 2,000 feet, and it stays underwater for up to 45 minutes. They like to attack their prey from underneath so that the fish are backlit or look like a silhouette.
All right, now this mammal doesn't like to travel too far from home. They usually don't migrate throughout their life and can be found within a few miles from wherever they were born. Now this animal is also very loud. Its sounds can be heard above the ice even when the creature still may be below. Now this animal has its own predators though, such as orcas and leopard seals.
Now, if you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you can have a chance to share the answer at the end of this show.
But every correct response will add to our Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season. Okay. I'm going to do a little review questions from a chemistry exam.
All right.
And it's one of those concepts that comes up, and I thought this was kind of cool because it was a kind of a tricky question.
Okay.
All right, so this is a question from last year's chemistry exam, and it says, which form represents compounds that are isomers of each other? So now, chemistry kids, you probably will tell you, an isomer means that the two molecules have the same number of atoms of each of the types of atoms, they're just arranged differently, okay? So same number, arranged differently. So let's look what we got here with the first one. We've got one carbon, followed by four hydrogens. This is methane, but over here we have ethane. We have two carbons with six hydrogens. So we know right away this one's wrong, okay? Number two, all right, we've got a carbon with an OH group on it and three hydrogens, okay? So this is methyl alcohol, and this one's tricky because if you look over here, well, look, this has got a hydrogen and it's got the OH group over there. It's actually the same molecule. That molecule wouldn't be any different if we just flipped it over one way or another. And this is the tricky one because you look at this, I think it probably gets a lot of kids, they look at this and say, oh, that one's different, look. But remember, it's the same number in the same arrangement. And so by just flipping the same molecule over, we'd still have the same thing. Now our other two are a little bit trickier, and I'm going to go number four right away, which is the wrong answer, because we can see right away we've got three carbons here, okay, and an OH group. Here we got two carbons in an OH group. So we got ethyl alcohol, we got propyl alcohol. This would be isopropyl alcohol because the OH is in the middle, okay? But because of the different number of carbons, we can see right away this isn't the right answer. And the one that is the right answer up here is going to be a little bit more involved. And it's a little trickier because here we have three carbons, hydrogens are all the way around, and an OH on the end, okay? So that makes it an alcohol, and there's three of them, so this would actually be propyl alcohol. Ah, but they tricked us over here. So let's look what we got. We've got three carbons. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hydrogens. All right. And one oxygen. If we look over here, we got a different arrangement because now we've got the oxygen in the middle. Notice we still have 1, 2, 3 carbons. All right. If we look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hydrogens, just like we had before. But now we have our oxygen in the middle here, and that gives us the one oxygen. So this is actually the correct answer. These are the two isomers. So remember the definition, same number of atoms just a different arrangement. But this was a trickier one because I think this probably would fool people because they saw same number of atoms. Looks like a different arrangement, but it's not, because this could be easily just flipped over. It would be the same thing. Now, when we used to have the kids build these three-dimensional, you can see it's the same molecule whether you flip it one way or another. But without being able to see that, just seeing it two-dimensionally here, hopefully you can picture in your mind that would be the same thing. So there's a little chemistry lesson for you.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
All right, so that was a great chemistry question, but now we're going to do a little bit of algebra, one of my favorite topics. I'm going to go over to the board here. And this might be a question that you would see in probably ninth grade, maybe some eighth graders. So what we need to do is we need to factor this polynomial completely. So first of all, some review on vocabulary. A polynomial is an algebra expression that has many terms to it, more than two. Binomial would be two. This is a trinomial because it has three terms on there. So when I looked at this factor completely, when I think about what does the word factor mean? When you factor something, you are finding all the numbers that go into it. So you're thinking about, like, you know, what goes into it. So if I'm thinking factors of the number 10, so 2 times 5. So when I look at this polynomial, this has factors too. We multiplied a bunch of terms together to get this, so we're going to factor it all out. So what we're going to do is, as we go to take a look at this, we look at this number, and the first thing I like to do is I'm going to try to simplify it by thinking, is there something that they all have in common? What number or what variable goes into all of them? So I kind of like to set mine up this way. I like to kind of do this little L on the outside, and I look at it, and is there any number that goes into all of these pieces? And when I look, I see 3, I see a negative 12 and a negative 36. I know that 3 goes into them. They're all multiples of 3, so that tells me that 3 is going to be a factor. So I'm going to pull out the 3. So we're going to see how many times 3 goes into each of these terms. 3 goes into 3x, x squared times. We could put a 1 in front of it, but we don't need to. 3 goes into negative 12x, negative 4 times, and I just bring down the x. And 3 goes into negative 36, negative 12 times. So as I wrote this out, I pulled out the 3. The next thing you do when you're trying to find the greatest common factor is you look at the variables and see if there's any variables that they all have in common. And when I look, I see this has an x squared, and I see this has an x, but this one doesn't have an x. So that tells me that there is nothing else that goes into these. So I've pulled out this factor of 3. So that's kind of the first step of what we're going to do with this. So this is the number 3 times x squared minus 4x minus 12. And that's great. So I did find the factors of this. 3 times this whole thing will get me that. But a big key word is, a lot of times when they write the word completely on there, it's kind of a hint to you that it can be factored again, that you're going to have to do more than one step when you're doing your factoring. So that's a big hint. Look for that completely word. So now I'm going to take this part here, which is still a trinomial, and I see it starts with x squared. So I'm kind of going to do like the reverse of FOIL. I'm going to try and think of a way that I would get x squared minus 4x minus 12. And I am a big fan of the area model. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to think about how to break this down, and we're going to use an area model to think about it. So we know we've got the 3 over here, and it's going to be 3 times our answer over here. But I'm trying to think about how I would get these numbers. And you always know the first term is going to go there, and you know the last term is going to go in the back corner. So as we try to think about this, we're going to break it down. How would we get these numbers, okay? So how could you get an x squared? How can you get an x squared? The only way to get an x squared is going to be x times x, okay? So x times x is x squared. And the last numbers in our binomial are going to multiply up to be negative 12. So I have to think of all the ways you could get a negative 12. Now, this is where it gets a little tricky. You could do a 1 and a 12, or a 12 and a 1. You could do a 3 and a 4. You could do a 2 and a 6. And how do you figure out which one it's going to be? Well, the other thing that happens is when we do the area model, we know that these two pieces, when I combine them, are going to get me a negative 4. So I got to think of pairs of numbers that when you multiply them, you get a negative 12. But when you add them, they sum up. to a negative 12. So let's just think about our pairs of numbers. We said we had a 1 and a 12, a 2 and a 6, and a 3 and a 4. Okay? So let's think about that. If I multiply these numbers together, I want to see how I could get a 12. And right now I'm not going to worry about the negative sign. So 1 times 12 could get me a 1 times 12 would get me a 12. And we're not going to worry about the negative sign just yet. And the way that we're going to do it is that if I combine these, when I go to add these two together, will I get a 4? Is there any way to get a 4 with those numbers, either adding or subtracting? And a 1 and a 12, think about your number of families way back to third grade. There's no way that you can get it. So 1 and a 12 isn't going to work for me, okay? Now we're going to try a 2 and a 6. 2 and a 6, I'm not going to worry about the negative signs just right now. 2 and a 6, is there any way that you can get 2 and a 6 that you would get a 4 from it? And you're like, oh yeah, I remember. If you do like 6 take away 2, you could get a 4, okay? So those do actually make a number family. So now we're going to play with it a little bit and we're going to play with the signs. So I know that we're going to have a 2 and I know that we're going to have a 6. Now in order to get a negative sign, one of those is going to have to be a negative, okay? So now I got to think about when I make one of them a negative, which one is going to get me a negative 4? So let's say I made the 2 negative, okay? Well, let's try the negative 2. If I have a negative 2 times a positive 6, I will get a negative 12. But if I add a negative 2 to a positive 6, you end up with a positive 4. So that's not going to be it. So then we're going to try it the other way. We're going to try putting the negative sign on the 6 and the positive sign on the 2. So 2 times x will get me a 2x, and a negative 6 times x will get me a negative 6. And it does happen when I combine these, a negative 6x and a positive 2x will get me a negative 4x. So the final factors of this thing, even though it looks a little messy, is going to be 3 times this term right there, which is x plus 2, times x minus 6. And the way that you would check your work is that you would multiply these all together and you'll end up with the original term.
I said, hey, hey. How do you know which century you live in? The 21st century is the 2000s. The 20th century is the 1900s. The 19th century is the 1800s. The 18th century is the 1700s. The 17th century is the 1600s, and so on.
All right, now we're going to go back to questions in just a minute, but we have our friends from Seneca Park Zoo here with us tonight. We have Hannah and Doug.
Yeah.
Hello, Doug. Tell us a little about Doug.
All right. Well, Doug is a southern three-banded armadillo. And the way that I like to remember that is if you look on his back here, use your three fingers, you can see he's got three bands.
Okay.
Now, we do have armadillos in the United States, usually nine-banded armadillos. He is a lot smaller than a nine-banded armadillo, and he actually comes from South America in the rainforest.
Oh.
One thing that makes him unique from a nine-banded armadillo is that he can actually close completely into a ball. Hmm. So right now he looks like he's pretty tight, but he can actually close so far that you can't see his feet, and then you can see his head and his tail. They're kind of triangular shaped. They fit together like puzzle pieces, mm-hmm. So you wouldn't be able to see any part of him.
So very how long cool. would he stay in a ball if he was frightened? Like, how could he sense whether the danger is gone or not? Can he see when he's in the ball?
No, he won't be able to see when he's in the ball, but as you might know, armadillos are mammals. So mammals have hair, and you can see on the side here, he has these little hairs, and you might be able to tell when I touch them, he moves a little bit. So you're right, when he's in his ball, he can't see with his eyes, but he does have a sensation in these little hairs. So if something is still outside, still smelling him and brushing past those hairs, he knows it's not safe to come out yet.
They also have a very good sense of smell, right?
Yes, an excellent sense of smell. So. He likes to eat insects like beetle larvae or termites or ants, and he needs to have a really great sense of smell to find them.
So when I look at him, he has these huge claws right there.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Those are basically like little shovels for him. He uses them to dig to find his food. Yeah, that's kind of where he got his name, too. Doug, Dig Doug.
Oh, okay. Oh, very cool.
Yeah.
Well, now tell us, in the zoo, what do we give Doug?
That's a good question. So at the zoo, Doug will get insects. In the wild, he'll also eat fruit occasionally, so he gets fruit as well at the zoo. Mm-hmm. He also gets what we call monkey chow. It's these little biscuits that we soak in water and kind of mash up. Okay. He might also eat dog food given the day. And like I said, he will get insects too.
Does he get to dig while he's at the zoo?
Kind of, yeah. We give him, he has a layer of cat litter in his exhibit, and he also gets a lot of shredded newspaper. So he loves to dig in that newspaper and into that cat litter and make himself a little nest.
Since he's a mammal, when she, if it was a female, had babies, how many do they usually have? Do they have one, two?
That's a good question. They have a litter of, They have more than one at a time.
Okay.
And they are born with this shell.
Okay, and then they nurse their young, too?
Yep.
All right, wow.
All right. Somebody forgot to turn their phone off. Sorry about that. I apologize. But you were talking about it being a mammal.
Yes.
And so let's talk about what this is here.
So his shell, like I said, he does have hair because he is a mammal. His shell is made out of the same stuff as our hair and our fingernails. It's actually called keratin. So it's basically like having really hard hair on his back, and it helps to protect him from predators such as jaguars. In fact, a jaguar is the only animal that would be able to open him up when he is closed.
So it's the same thing like in a horn of like a rhino or something?
Exactly.
Wow.
Yeah. It's a whole skin full of fingernails.
Exactly.
Well, thank you, Hannah, and thanks for bringing Doug in. That's very cool.
Been here before. He's happy to be back.
Good to have him back, and thank you. All right.
Do you want to know more about armadillos and other animals like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on the videos. We're going to be back in a few seconds.
I said, hey, hey.
The order to solve a long division problem is divide, multiply, subtract, bring down. You can remember this order with a family: dad, mom, sister, brother.
Okay, that was kind of cool with Doug, wasn't it?
I love armadillos.
Yeah. Well, I have another chemistry question.
Can't get enough of it.
A little biology. Now we got to do chemistry. It's a science day, right? All right. Now this is off the same exam, the same chemistry exam, but this is one of the part two questions or part B or C questions here. And this one says we have 1 mole sample of glucose. Now, for this one, I'm just going to talk about that word mole. Science kids know is an amount. It's like saying a dozen or a gross, only it's a huge amount. All right. But we won't need to do that for this. But at glucose, all you living environment kids have seen this, the C6H12O6. So that's any of our sugars, simple sugars. Completely reacts with oxygen is represented by the balanced equation below. Now, when we say an equation is balanced, because of conservation of mass, whatever we have on the side here with our reactants has to be the same amount of atoms we have on their side of our products. So for us, they balance this equation. So for every 1 molecule of glucose, 6 molecules of oxygen, and that's O2, would produce 6 molecules of carbon dioxide, 6 molecules of water, plus energy. All right, good thing for us because that's where we get our energy. But now let's go. There's 2 questions associated with this prompt here. The first one asks us to write an empirical formula for glucose. So here's our glucose here, the C6H12O6. Now, when it's asking for an empirical formula, that's kind of cool. Empirical formulas, now we're going to go into math, as Laura will like this part. Empirical formula is written as the simplest whole number ratio of the atoms. So this is very similar to what Laura just did when she was factoring. If we look what we have here, we've got C6H12O6. And what Laura did a minute ago when she was factoring was she looked what would go into all these numbers. Now remember I said I want the simplest whole number ratio, so I'm going to look for the largest number that will go into these three numbers. So we have 6, 12, and 6. That largest number will be 6. So the empirical formula for this, that simplest whole number ratio, would be CH2O. Why did I do it that way? Well, all I did was divided each one of these numbers by 6. All right? So there's 6 carbons. That means we have 1. There's 12 hydrogens. We'd have 2. 6 oxygens. we have one oxygen. So whenever you're doing empirical formulas, it isn't that difficult. You want the simplest whole number ratios. It's tricky sometimes when you have molecules that have an odd number of something, and sometimes the molecular formula is the same thing as the actual empirical formula. They're no different. Let's look at the second one quickly. This one's a little bit different. It says using the axis that's in your answer booklet, write the potential energy curve for the reaction of glucose with oxygen. All right, we don't have the answer booklet, so I'm going to put my own potential energy curve in here. And if we go back to what we saw up here, we saw that this gave off energy. This is what your chemistry goods will call an exothermic reaction. And luckily for us, because that's where we get our energy, is from that glucose. So when we do this, if we have the potential energy increasing going this way, okay, and this is our reaction coordinate going this way, they want us to write the curve for this reaction. Well, this is an exothermic reaction. It gives off energy. So if we started out with a certain amount of energy up here in our reactants, we know that our products are going to have less energy because some of that energy was given off. But how do we get from there to there? There's always a certain amount of energy we need to put in to get a reaction to go. That's called the activation energy. And so this would represent that potential energy diagram. We've got a certain amount of energy stored here in the bonds of our reactant molecule, the glucose and the oxygen. It takes some energy to break those apart to get up to this point with this reactive activation complex where this reaction can go. So now as these bonds reform to produce the product, energy is released, and we actually end up with less energy stored in the products than was up here in the reactants. That's that energy was given off and would have been used by that living thing to carry on their life processes. So hopefully you liked our little review of potential energy diagrams.
Some of the most famous composers, such as Mozart, Strauss, and Schubert, were born in this musically inclined country. There are about 8 million people that live in Austria, and 98% of them speak German. Austria is divided into 9 independent federal regions, and parts of the movie The Sound of Music were shot in the city of Salzburg. Austria was also the first country to use postcards.
And you have
another math one. We're going to compete. Right. You know, for every two of your science, I'm going to throw a math problem out there. Right. So let me go on over to the board here. The problem we're going to do is a simple two-step equation, a nice review. You guys in sixth and seventh grade, this is a great problem for you guys to be paying attention to. So we have 3x plus 4 is equal to negative 11. And what we want to do is we want to solve for x. What number, if you multiply it by 3 and then add 4 to it, equals 11? And I know a lot of kids do trial and error. They just keep trying different numbers. But once you come up and know how to solve it algebraically, it makes your life a lot easier. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a line down the middle, and I know that the left side and the right side are balanced. And what I want to do is I want to isolate the x. I want to get that x alone. So I'm going to do the inverse. I'm going to do the opposite of everything that's going on with it. So when I see we have the 3x plus 4, I want to do the opposite of adding 4, which is to subtract 4. But to keep an equation balanced, whatever you do the left side, you got to do the right side. So I'm going to take 4 away from this side. So if I had 4 and I took away 4, they kind of cancel each other out. And all I have left on this side is a 3x. And if I have a negative 11 and I combine it with another negative 4, you're going to have negative 15 altogether. So I get down, when I simplify this, you could already see that instead of it being a problem that is wide, it's now getting a little bit more narrow. So I have 3x equals negative 15. So now I got to think about, well, who's still bothering the variable? What's happening with it? What operation is there? We're multiplying it by 3. So the opposite of multiplying by 3 is going to be to divide by 3. And if I do it to the left side, you got to do it to the right side to keep it balanced. 3 divided by 3 just leaves me with an x, which, as I told you, you'd be done when you got the x all by itself. And negative 15 divided by 3 is a negative 5. So the answer to that problem is x equals negative 5. So that means if I multiplied 3 by negative 5 and added 4, I would get the number negative 11.
Okay, Matthew is our winner in tonight's creature teaser. Hello, Matthew.
Hello.
How are you today?
Good.
Matthew, what's our answer?
Weddell seal.
The Weddell seal, very cool. How did you know that? Did you look it up or did you know that?
I looked it up.
That's great.
I mean, it's amazing that it could be underwater for 45 minutes.
Yeah. Yep. What grade are you in, Matthew?
Fifth grade.
And where do you go to school?
Green, New York.
Green, New York?
Oh,
down near Binghamton area, isn't it?
No, the Catskills, right?
Is it?
Binghamton?
Near Binghamton?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I thought. Yeah, very cool. Well, I hope your teacher's watching and gives you extra credit for that because.
Okay.
All right. Well, thanks for calling, Matthew, and congratulations. But don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homer Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
All right, now tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll continue our series called Move to Include. Good night.
Good night. Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.